This is the problems lecture of the week that starts in the 10th of May, and this lecture is related with solving and analyzing linear programming problems. So we are going to work only with one problem, problem 3.7, which is related with a typical production situation. So let's look to the problem data. We want to produce computer desks, and we have two models, a normal model for which we have a market limitation. There is no demand for more than 70 desks a month. And we have a model with a special compartment to place the computer. So to produce these desks, we need to use two production departments, a stamping department in which we have 320 machine hours per month, and the assembly and finishing department in which we have 300 man hours per month. So the normal desks provide us a contribution margin of 40 euros per unit, and the compartment desks provide us a contribution margin of 20 euros per unit. So we have here some information relating with the production process. For example, normal desks require 2 hours of the stamping department and 3 hours of the assembly and finishing department, while computer desks require 4 and 3. So in this table, we summarize the data involved in this problem. Now, in this problem, we have three main questions. The first one, we need to formulate the linear programming problem, and we need to find the solution using the graphical method. So let's start with the formulation of the problem. To formulate the problem, we need to start by identifying the objective. So this is a typical production problem. We have the contribution margins of each product. So the objective is to maximize the total contribution margin. So in terms of the decision variables, we need to control the quantities produced of each desk. So we are going to select X1 for the normal desks and X2 for the special desks with the computer compartment. In terms of the restrictions, we have two kinds of restrictions. We have the availability of the resources, and we have also demand limitations. Since we already have the decision variables, we can start writing the problem. We assigned X1 to the quantities of normal desks, and we assigned X2 to the quantity of special desks. So to obtain the total contribution margin, we multiply the quantities by the unit contribution margins. So the total contribution margin for normal desks is 40x1, and for special desks we have 20x2. In terms of restrictions, the resources used in stamping department, each unit of normal desks takes 2 hours, and each unit of special desks takes 4 hours. So 2 multiplied by x1 is the number of hours used to produce the total of normal desks, and 4 x2 stands for the number of hours necessary to produce the special desks, and the hours available are 320. So this is what we are going to use. This is what is available. And we have the same thing for the assembly and finishing department. In that case, we have 3x1 and 3x2 cannot exceed 300 hours. And finally, we have the market condition, that is x1 cannot exceed 70, that is x1 less or equal than 70. And these are quantities, x1 and x2 are quantities. This is a continuous process. So x1 and x2 must be greater or equal than 0. So let's look now to the graphical solution, and let's start by characterizing the solution domain. To do this, we need to identify the boundaries defined by the restrictions. So, and the boundaries are defined by the condition of equality. So, for example, for restriction number one, we have this line, and our objective is to identify the points in which this line crosses the axis. To find the intersection with the horizontal axis, we consider x2 equal to 0, and we get x1 is equal to 320 divided by 2, that is 160. And for the vertical intersection, we consider x1 equal to 0. So, and we get x2 equal to 320 divided by 4, that is 80. So, we also rewrite this expression in the way that we can identify the inclination of the line. That is, we write x2 equal to some constant b less the inclination that multiplies x1. So in this way, we can rewrite this restriction in this way, and here is the inclination. Okay, so the inclination of this line is minus 0.5. So we can do the same for the second restriction, and we get these intersections, 100 and 100, and the inclination in this case is minus 1. Restriction 3, it's the marked condition, it's a vertical line. So that crosses the horizontal axis in x1 equal to 70, so the inclination is infinite. So looking to the set of these inclinations, we can also evaluate the inclinations of the lines of z to try to anticipate the location of the optimal. So we have here the line of z, z equals 3400, it can be any line. And so this line can be written in this way, and we can rewrite it in the same way, so that we can identify the inclination. So the inclination is minus 2. So from this, the set of the inclinations relate with the restrictions, and taking in account the inclination of the lines of z, we can have this situation, that is, the inclination of the lines of z are between restriction, the inclination of restriction 1 and restriction 3, that is minus 0.5 and infinite, because we have here 2. Or we can have this situation between the inclinations of the lines of z are between the inclinations of the second restriction and the third restriction. So the optimal will be in the cross of restriction 1 and restriction 3, or between the cross of restriction 2 and restriction 3. And now we can identify the optimal solution. So we start to identify the solution domain. So we saw, for example, that restriction 1 crosses the vertical axis in 80 and the horizontal axis in 160. We saw that restriction 2, that is presented in green, crosses is in 100 and 100, so in the vertical and the horizontal axis. And the restriction 3, that is presented in brown, crosses only the horizontal axis in 70. And so the solution domain is the intersection of the sets defined by the three conditions. So this is the solution domain. And in solution domain, the candidates to optimal points are only the vertices. So we have here two other crosses, but only these are inside the solution domain, so we cannot consider the other two points. So as we can see, we have here in pink the inclinations of the lines of z, in particular the line that crosses this point, and we can see that this must be the optimal solution, because when we consider lines with the same inclination but traveling from here, we arrive to the conclusion that the longest distance that they can travel and still have a point in solution domain is this one that still has that point there. So this is the optimal solution. We can confirm also that this is the optimal solution because the vertices of the solution domain are the ones that we have now here. So we have, of course, this point here. I'm going to erase this. So we have this point here, but in this point, the value of z is zero. So we have in this table the value of z in each of these vertices. For example, in this one, 080, we have the value of z, 1600. In this one here, we have the value 2800. The value of z in this point is 3400. And here in the last vertex, we have 2800. So this is, in fact, the optimal solution. Now let's consider the second question. In this question, we need to reformulate the problem so that it can be solved using the simplex method, and we must present the initial table. So the initial table. Then we must identify the next base, that is the next set of basic variables, and you must say if that set is the one that corresponds to the optimal solution or not. So in terms of the modification of the problem, since we have restrictions of the less or equal type, we just need to introduce the slack variables. S1 in the first restriction, S2 in the second, and S3 in the third. We need to rewrite Z, so transferring everything to the first hand side, as we show here. Okay? And then we just need to build the table. The table, we identify first the decision variables, and then we introduce the variables used to transform the inequalities. And then we just need to introduce the coefficients. So we start with the line of Z. So we have these coefficients here. This one, minus 40 and minus 20, which we have here in X1 and X2. And we don't have more terms, so everything is zero. Now we consider the first restriction. We have 2, 4 and 1 in S1. That is, we have 2, 4 and 1 in S1, and then we have the independent term, 320, and so on, until we have the rest of the table. And this is the first part of the question. So in the second part, we need to identify the next base, and then we need to say if that base is optimal or not. So let's start with the initial base. So the initial base is composed by this set of variables, S1, S2, and S3, which we identify by these unit vectors, which we also list here on the left. So this choice is not the optimal one. It's not the optimal one. So the solution that we have here is, of course, for these variables here, we have these values. And this is, of course, obtained considering the other variables, that is X1 and X2 equal to 0. So, as I was saying, the solution is not optimal because we have these negative coefficients here in X1, 40, and in X2, minus 20. So, the meaning of these negative coefficients, as we already saw many times, is, for example, for the case of X1, we have dz, dx1 is symmetric of that is, it is 40. So this is what is important here, is that it is greater than 0. And the solution that we have here is obtained considering x1 equal to 0. Okay, so this combination tells me that the solution is not optimal, because if I change this condition, and change this condition is only possible in this way, because x1 is can only be greater or equal than 0, so any change can only be implemented in this way. This, because this is positive, this will imply that we will have an increase in z. Okay, so this means that z can improve from here, and if z can improve, this is not the optimal solution. So if this is not the optimal solution, we need to find a different configuration. So this is not the right set, And if this is not the right set, we are going to introduce a new variable in the basic set. And the variable that we are going to introduce is this one, x1, because it has the highest partial derivative. So x1 goes to the next to the next base. And we signal that introducing this this arrow here. Okay. Now, if x1 goes to the base, one of these, that is one of these, should go out. And to see which goes out, we need to evaluate the values that x1 can have in the next iteration. And we do this here on this right side. So we divide this coefficient by this, for example, and we get 180. Then we divide 300 by 3, and we get 100. And finally, we divide 70 by 1, and we get 70. So we need to select the lowest possibility, otherwise we will get negative values. So S3 must go out. Okay, S3 must go out. So this must be replaced by X1. So the new base will have X1 and S2, and in the place of S3, we'll have X1. And the non-basic variables must next be X2 and, of course, S3. So, and next we need to say if this new choice, is the optimal one or not. Now, to evaluate the optimality of the new base, we just need to rewrite Z in terms of X2 and S3, that is the new set of non-basic variables. So we have here the previous line of Z, the initial line of Z. So in order to represent Z as a function of these two variables, this coefficient here must be set to zero, that is, we must have in the next table a value of zero there. And to obtain a value of zero there, we use the pivot line, which is the third line of the previous table, because we in the previous table, we already have a coefficient one here, and of course, in the next iteration, the objective is to make the column of X1 a unit vector with this configuration, but we already have one there, so we can use it directly. So to make this coefficient zero, we need to use the pivot line, and we should multiply it by the symmetric of this value. That is what we identify here. So and here it is. This is the last line multiplied by 40. Now, adding these two lines, we obtain the new line of Z. So this is the new line of Z. And we can write it. We can extract what we have here. So essentially, what we get is Z is equal to this plus the symmetric of this multiplied by X2 and symmetric of this multiplied by S3, which we have here. So and now we can see clearly that we have here this this coefficient, this positive partial derivative, or this negative coefficient here. And but the new solution will be obtained setting the non-basic variables equal to zero. That is, we will consider X2 and S3 equal to zero to extract a solution. So we conclude from this that this configuration is not also the optimal one yet. So let's consider now the last question, question number three. In this question, we want to increase the availability of only one of the resources. And we have three questions related with this. The first one is, which resource can we increase? So to answer this question, we need to analyze what's happening when we increase the availability of one of the resources. Let's consider, for example, resource number one, which is represented by the line in blue. So with the original availability, we obtain these intersections, okay, that we divide the availability by the coefficients of x1 and x2 to obtain these points. if we increase the availability, well, we increase this the value of these intersections. That is, we move to these points. Okay, but as we can see, the optimal solution is here. Now, this means that originally we have an excess of hours in the first section. So having more hours there will not affect the optimal solution. So the line crosses, for example, here the line of restriction 3 in this point originally, and then it will cross it here. No impact on the expansion of the solution domain. Okay, so the solution domain is expanded in this region, but the line of Z will not. So it's on the left on the line of Z. That is, the line of Z will not move with this movement. Okay, so restriction number 3 is not a resource. So the only possibility is to increase the availability of resource number 2. That is the second section. And as we can see, this resource is represented by the line in green. And if we have more, the translation will move the optimal from this point to the new intersection, because the inclinations of the lines doesn't change. It means that the optimal will be defined by the same two lines. And of course, it will move to an upper point, that is, Z will increase. So this is what should be done: increase the availability of resource number 2. Now, in the second part of the question, we want to evaluate the maximum number of hours that compensates to acquire. So we have this figure that will help us answering this question. So we have here the previous line that defines the boundary of the second restriction, so in green, but in this dashed way, and that we will move this line, we will move this line until it's still have at least one point in the solution domain. So we can see that we will move it up to this point here, which is defined by the intersection between restriction 1 and restriction 3, because after here it will be outside the solution domain. The solution domain will remain fixed by that point. So we move it up to there. So if we move it up to there, we can read the coordinates of that point, or we can evaluate the coordinates of that point. So, and this is the new second restriction. We don't know the availability. But we know that this point also belongs to this line. So using the coordinates of that point, we can evaluate the new availability. And here we have 345 man hours. So originally we have this amount. This means that we can increase it by 45 man hours. And finally, we are going to evaluate the maximum price that we can pay for each of these extra hours. So, with the increasing of availability, we move from this point to that point. That is, the intersection between the line that represents restriction 2 and line that represents restriction 3 moves to that point, and the optimal solution moves also to that point, because the optimal remains defined by these two lines. So these are the coordinates of the new optimal solution, and we can evaluate the value of Z in this point if we could increase the availability without paying extra money for that. That is, with these coordinates, we can evaluate the value of Z if we could obtain an increase in availability without extra costs. So we would move to this amount, to 3,700, And previously, we have this amount, 3,400. That is, we have an increase, we could have an increase of 300 euros. But 300 euros for 45 hours. So per hour, we need to divide this quantity to get this amount, 6 euros and 67 cents. And this, in fact, represents the shadow price of resource number two. And this is it. This is the end of this lecture. And thank you for your attention, and see you in the next one.